So obviously you end up selling it for $1 billion in cash, which I think a lot of people, when they hear a number like, hey, I sold my company for $1 billion, most deals are stock and equity and earnouts. Like, that was just cash. And so I ask every single person, what do you do when you see $1 billion wired, right? Like, you know, I just imagine you look in the bank account and there is $1 billion. What is the reaction?
You know, I have a weird relationship with money, if I'm being totally honest. I don't know, I got up the next morning, I went to work. Like, and I'm not saying that I wasn't, you know, so proud of it. And, but it's really like, it didn't change anything about what I still wanted to do. And I just got up and I went to work. I have a guy that is my financial advisor, and I have told this story, but it was not that long ago. And he came into the office and he basically said, well, you live in the same house, you drive the same car. And then he looks at me and he goes, I'm pretty sure you were wearing that the last time I saw you. So we're good. It was unbelievable, but the work wasn't done. You know, the work was just like getting started for getting it to market. So there were little moments of reflection. I will share, Gail King had me on CBS this morning to announce the approval. And, you know, that was the pressure sitting in the green room at CBS this morning and getting on set. And then the next day we were on Squawk Box and announced the sale. And she wrote me a little email and she's like, oh, sure, you couldn't have said that on my program. And she's like, you are a badass. And I still have it on my desk. Like, it was so flattering. So moments like that really, you know, made a huge impression on me.
For sure. And so since then, you've gone on to do investing, Pincubator, a bunch of things to kind of help other women or women-focused businesses. Maybe talk a little bit about some of the other stuff you did, and then we'll get to the really fun part where you may or may not get the drug back.
So, you know, what's crazy is I sold the business. I thought I was going to stay. Maybe it's a classic story of, you know, founder, mama bear, not getting along with new acquirer. I was invited to leave, as I like to say. And I had to like sit on the sidelines and, you know, check myself. They paid $1 billion for it. Know that I still would be there and cheering it on, but also figure out like what's next. And it's extraordinary, right? Like if you can have any possibility or you have no possibility, what do you choose? And for me, I think that what was so clear is I had literally lived a front row lesson in what it means to advocate for yourself and for other women. And look, I'm not actually somebody who talks a lot about, you know, was I in a male dominated industry? Were there crazy moments in, you know, in a room where you were marginalized or whatever? Sure, but I was gonna get through it. Like, I understand it. It's very different for me to like experience that at a mass scale. And so I thought, well, the hell, like I need to invest in disruption. Like I don't only want to disrupt in the market for technologies that we need in women's health. I want to disrupt a mindset of who has the next $1 billion idea. And that matters to me. And Pomp knows some of the profile of women that I invest in. And you know, I've got this great engineer, but she's gorgeous. Like she's 5'10", she's blonde, she's Texan. And let's be honest, like when she shows up on Sand Hill Road, they're sort of like, okay. You know, like it's very hard to actually get beyond that, but she's gonna sell her company for hundreds of millions of dollars. And like the next time somebody looks like her walks in the room, we all reach for our wallet. That is like part of the design. And so it's been wonderful for me to get to invest in things that not only I think are groundbreaking first. I love the big challenges. Take the big crazy ass swing, right? That has little probability of going through. I think we're pretty good at that. And they're often like catalysts in social change as well that just matter to me. Flushable pregnancy test.
Yeah. So I can say this because I know you well enough. And I asked you one time behind closed doors, you could have lied, you know, all through your teeth to the public. But behind closed doors, I said to you, why are you doing this? And this is when you were investing and kind of really, you know, pressing the gas on the incubator. And you said to me, to make women fucking rich.
Yes, that's right.
And I remember just walking out of there being like, Cindy is a fucking badass.
That actually was so controversial when when you first start, people are like, well, what's the mission? Well, what are you doing? Blah, 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 blah. And you try to explain them. I'm like, to make women really fucking rich. And you know, we should, all of us should want that. May the best man or woman win. Just give it a fair shake. Let's not overlook an idea because we think it's niche, because it affects half of the population. I'll take that idea. And I mean, that really does happen. Just by the numbers is how you bear it out, right? 4% of investment dollars go to women's health research. That's crazy. And so those are the things that really ignite me. And it is about picking people who are going to get to a finish line. Like I think you're a founder CEO or you're a forever CEO. I'm a founder CEO. I like to build it. I like to build it from scratch and create enough value that somebody else comes in and acquires it. And that's really the profile of the companies I'm taking on too.